Hi all, in this video I'm just going to be giving some tips on how to solder. You'll obviously need a soldering iron and some solder and something to clean the soldering iron with. This is what I use. It's a waterless tip cleaner. You can also use a wet sponge, just any old household wet sponge, to clean the tip of your soldering iron. My soldering iron is a Goot, which is spelt G-O-O-T. If you're in Australia and you want a decent quality soldering, or good quality soldering iron, get a Goot. If you're in America, I think Weller are the quality brand in America. I've had the cheaper ones and they do an okay job, but they don't heat up as fast as these, and the tips generally don't last as long as these. And they also have my last one, actually the handle actually heat up. If I left it on for about an hour, the handle would actually start to heat up. It's just not as good quality as this one, but they still work okay. A couple of other options that I find useful is a desk lamp like this one. Just folds up like that and switches off. It's a fluoro, so it's got a really good light and you can see exactly what you're doing. It helps to see how your soldering is going. And also a little desk fan. I had one, it actually broke, but just a little desk fan to blow the fumes away if you plan to do soldering for a few hours. They're not supposed to be very good for you, so the desk fan can help. Before you even start soldering, I find it's a good idea to give the board a bit of a clean. Just use a scourer, an abrasive sponge with some abrasive cleaner, like a cream cleanser. And you can see with this board, it's just a Vero board. If I get it in the right light, you can see half of it's shiny and the other half's not. The half next to my finger's has got corrosion on it, whereas the other half is quite shiny. It's not really showing up that well in this video, but in person you can see it's a lot shinier. So you just want to get rid of those contaminants before you start soldering, because the contaminants make the solder resist sticking to the board. So it's a good idea just to give them a quick clean, just to get excess contaminants off the board before you start. So I'll just be using this Vero board to do a few test solder joints. It's a good idea to do this if you're new to soldering before you start your project, just to get a bit of practice with how to solder. It's straightforward to do a solder joint, but it's a bit of a skill to do a proper solder joint. So I'll show you some tips on how to get a good solder joint though. So I'm just going to be using some of this link wire that I've got. It's just unshielded wire, and a bit of tape to hold it down onto the board, and then solder through on the other side. So put it through like that and just bend it over the side that doesn't have the copper, and then put some tape on the back of it like that, just to hold it in place while you solder, so it doesn't fall out. Helps to keep it in place. I usually try and make sure that the lead on the other side is straight. If you have it bent like this and you go to solder it, the solder kind of tries to fill up between the gap and the lead, not to the extreme that it would come this far, but it comes down a little bit and it encourages solder bridges. So I usually try and solder it in with the lead straight. Before you attempt to actually do the solder joint, make sure your soldering iron is heated up properly. So mine usually takes a couple of minutes to heat up. It's actually a 46 watt, which is a relatively high wattage, but it would be hot enough in about 30 seconds to do a solder joint. But if you want to wait until it's properly heated up, give it a couple of minutes. You need to heat up the track and the lead as well as the solder. If the track and the lead aren't heated up, it's more likely you're going to have cold solder joints. A cold solder joint is where the solder has melted and it looks like a normal solder joint, but it has a bit of a dull appearance, a bit of a dull surface, and it's actually not connected properly to either the track or the component. These sort of joints can crack easily. If it's soldered on, you move the lead around, you might see that there's fractures in the actual solder, and obviously you don't want that, because with guitar pedals and things like that, if you've got components in, you might find you're having a board that's got an intermittent problem when you tap it. The audio signals cutting out or you're getting some strange problems, it can be a cold solder joint. If you get a cold solder joint, just use a solder sucker or some solder braid. This is my solder sucker, this is what I use. It's done me well. I used to use braid, I don't like it. This thing is just so much easier. You just heat up the solder and then just you hit this button and it just sucks the solder away, as the name suggests. Or solder bulbs are a similar sort of concept as a solder sucker, so you can get one of those as well. These are only about $10, they're not that expensive. So you just use the solder sucker to remove the solder from the joint and then just redo the joint again. You don't want to pack on the solder too thick too. If it bulges over the edges, it's too much. And if you haven't actually filled around the whole lead, then it's probably too little as well. It should just have a bit of a concave appearance when it's finished. Also, one thing you can do before you start actually soldering is to tin the end of your soldering iron. This one's looking a little bit under tinned. It needs some, I don't know if you can see on the video. Move the light a bit. Yeah, it's looking a little bit under tinned. So you basically just feed on solder onto the end and just cover it. Just be careful when you do it because it builds up on the end and it drips. So have your cleaner ready for when you do that. So it should be all shiny when you're finished. You also do this when you finish using your soldering iron, it protects the tip. I obviously didn't do it the last time because it's too thin. And just do that a few times. Okay, so my soldering iron looks like it's hot enough, so just pull off a bit of the wire. I usually sort of unfeed a whole bunch of it like that so it's easy to get into the spot. I'll just zoom the camera in so you can see the actual solder joint. And then you just take the soldering iron, leave the soldering iron on the track and the lead for a couple of seconds to make sure that it heats up. And you just touch the solder onto the track and the lead and it'll actually start flowing. You're not supposed to touch the tip with the soldering iron, you're actually supposed to touch the track and the lead with the soldering iron, and you have the soldering iron on the other side of the lead. I sort of cheat a bit and I actually just touch it a little bit with the soldering iron to get it started, and then I just pull it away and it'll just keep flowing that way. Just make sure you leave the tip on the lead for a couple of seconds to make sure that the lead and the track are heated up. Otherwise you'll get those cold solder joints that I was just telling you about. So that looks like a pretty good solder joint. Bit difficult to tell, but yeah, that solder joint turned out well. So you can keep doing that until you get the general idea of how to solder and just keep going along. One other thing, you don't actually clean the iron tip when you finish soldering the joint. You actually clean it before you do the next joint. So you leave the solder on the end of the tip. And when you finish using, like I said before, when you finish using the soldering iron, leave a bit of solder on the end of the tip because it helps protect the tip from corrosion. Sometimes if you leave the soldering iron for too long on the track, you'll notice that the track starts to bulge a bit. And if you keep heating up that track, it'll start to lift. You don't want that, a lift track. It's a bit of a pain to fix. So just make sure that if you're holding the soldering iron on the one track for a long time and you're having difficulty with a particular joint, just remove the solder from the joint, fix it up, and then redo it from scratch. Because if you just hold it there continually for a minute while you're trying to fix this joint, it'll actually, the track can come off the fiberglass, and yeah, as I said, it's a bit of a pain trying to actually fix a lifted track. Some of the components that you need to be careful of with the heat from the soldering iron, germanium diodes and things like that. The germanium transistors from the 70s, if you're doing a fuzz face, you need to be careful with the heat. In fact, I would recommend doing sockets for a germanium transistor and not soldering directly onto the transistor leads. Same with the diodes, it's just easier to put a couple of sockets into the board and then just put your diode straight in. Also be wary if you're drilling your own PCBs, not to drill the holes out too big in the board, because if you're soldering in a small lead into a large hole, there's a big gap between the lead and the hole and they become quite difficult to get a proper solder joint. You don't want to have a hole that's much bigger than the lead. I was using a drill bit for a while that was, I think, a 1 mil, and it was too big, or maybe even being bigger than a 1 mil, but it was too big, and I was finding that my soldering was very poor. I was getting solder bridges everywhere, and I couldn't work out why the solder wasn't actually sticking to the track, and it was because the hole was too big for the lead. I just couldn't get the lead to connect to the track properly because of that gap. So make sure that your holes aren't a lot bigger than your actual leads too. If you're new to soldering, you might think that it's just a bit of a chore, there's not really much skill involved. But the more you solder, you start to realize that you're getting better at it, and you're having less mistakes, less solder bridges. A solder bridge is where two leads, you've accidentally connected two tracks together that shouldn't be connected together. Less cold solder joints and things like that, and you can avoid those things by the tips that I've told you. So that's it for this video. If you want to see more do-it-yourself guitar pedal tutorials, demos, and all sorts of stuff like that, check out my channel, and don't forget to subscribe. Thanks for watching.